Good day to everyone. Today I will present different sulfides which can be used in photocatalysis, and then I will present the works of a few of them that we have made in our institute. I will give, first of all, an overview of sulfides of several kinds which can be used in photocatalysis. Then I will present how the spectral response of indium sulfide and tin disulfide agrees with the experimental band gaps. Some details on the mechanism of the degradation of the rhodamine B dye when combined with indium sulfide, and finally, how the spectral response of indium sulfide can be extended by partially substituting it with vanadium. Then I will show a few details on work of ours using zinc indium sulfide, evidencing that it can be used, it can use a wavelength ranges a bit larger than would be expected from its band gap. And finally, how we can couple enzymes and sulfides to achieve water splitting in hydrogen and oxygen or CO2 reduction to formate. Let me present first three slides on different sulfides used for photocatalysis. In all cases, I will give their band gaps, and also I will give only one reference of them. But in all cases, you may choose any of these sulfides to verify, indicating their formula and asking for photocatalysis or photocatalyst, how many results can you get. Here I present sulfides displaying very different coordinations. First of all, mercuric sulfide, that is cinnabar. Then the silver and the copper sulfide. Then monocopper sulfide, which includes the disulfide ions, as you can see. And finally, bismuth sulfide. As you can see, there is a very large variety of coordinations. Then I show several sulfides that present exclusively tetrahedral coordination. Of course, zinc sulfide, because of its high band gap, can only absorb UV light. The other sulfides do allow absorbing visible light, and in some cases, infrared light. Cadmium sulfide, for example, is the typical reference compound with which other materials are compared. I will show later such comparison in slides 6 and 8. The chalcopyrite, silver gallium sulfide, copper gallium sulfide, and copper indium sulfide have decreasing band gaps. And especially the latter, sometimes mixed with selenide, is used as main absorber in photovoltaic cells. But because indium is a costly material, the gesterate material, copper zinc tin sulfide, can be used, which has the same band gap as copper indium sulfide. And now I present octahedrally or prismatically coordinated sulfides. These are molybdenum sulfide, tungsten disulfide, zirconium sulfide, and lead sulfide, as well as pyrite. One interesting thing is that molybdenum sulfide, when prismatically coordinated, is a semiconductor. But when octahedrally coordinated, it is a metal, and is used very effectively in electrolysis for the hydrogen evolution reaction. The same thing happens in the case of octahedrally coordinated tungsten sulfide. On the other hand, zirconium sulfide, like hafnium sulfide, has octahedral coordination, but because it has no electron in the D shell, it is a semiconductor. Finally, pyrite, which contains disulfide ions, and octahedrally coordinated lead sulfide, both of them being cubic, have band gaps below 1 electron volt and are useful mainly in combination with other materials. Let's turn now in first place to the sulfides indium sulfide, which has a 3-dimensional cation defective structure with a direct band gap of 2.0 electron volts, and tin disulfide, which has a layered structure with an indirect band gap of 2.2 electron volts. One particularly interesting thing is that, according to the literature, you can see the reference here at the center bottom, both sulfides straddle the standard redox potentials of hydrogen and oxygen evolution from water, which makes them particularly good candidates for those processes. Let's look first at indium sulfide, which results are included in this reference here in the upper left. When prepared hydrothermally, it shows a rather good specific surface area. And as you see in the left part, it is more active in the left in the elimination of aqueous formic acid than the typical reference compound cadmium sulfide. The most likely mechanism being shown here. And it's also less prone to photocorrosion than cadmium sulfide. What is more interesting to see is that its spectral response, measured with the filters shown here, allowed to distinguish the different wavelengths and consequently confirms that there is a rather good agreement with its bandgap. This means that it can use at least all wavelengths shorter than 600 nanometers. Now let's look at tin disulfide. Again, it was prepared hydrothermally according to the reference shown here at the upper left, and it gave also a good specific surface area. As you can see here, it is much more active than cadmium sulfide in the degradation of aqueous formic acid, and the likely mechanism is being again as shown here. And it is also much less prone to photocorrosion than cadmium sulfide. Again, we see that its spectral response, measured with the filters shown here, agrees quite well with its band gap. The reason that its spectral response follows a less steep profile is the same as in the case of the spectrum shown here, because the band gap is indirect. Let's see now what we can learn on the degradation mechanism of the rhodamine B dye when using indium sulfide. The reference is that given in the upper left part. If we just check the rate at which it is degraded with different filters, the same as we used previously, we see the corresponding evolution monitoring the 554 nanometers wavelength. But there is an interesting result. When comparing the results under nitrogen and oxygen bubbling, we see clear differences. Furthermore, in both cases, there are no isospecific points, which means that there are at least three components in the degradation process. By carrying out a partial component analysis, we were able to see that there were only three components in the degradation. And by comparing with literature data, we could end up verifying that the mechanism is as shown here at the center left. The fact that with oxygen bubbling, the reaction works much faster than with nitrogen bubbling means that the two first steps depend mainly on the more aggressive OH radicals, while only with oxygen bubbling can the degradation be finally completed, which means that oxygen, O2 minus radicals or OH, O2H radicals are needed for this final degradation. Finally, the partial component analysis was carried out for all filtered wavelengths and reaction steps. And adjusting the initial rate of rhodamine B degradation, we could verify that the wavelength dependence was that of indium sulfide, not that of the absorption by the rhodamine B dye. Now, let's see what happens when indium sulfide is partially substituted with vanadium. The reference for its preparation is that shown here at the left. The first thing to take into account is that because vanadium trichloride was used in order to make an isovalent substitution of indium by vanadium, it was necessary to make the reaction under nitrogen. And besides, we had to use an ethylene glycol water mixture in the proportions indicated here, in order to avoid as much as possible the reactions shown here. In this way, it was possible to see that according to the high resolution transmission electron microscopy shown here, the vanadium ions are well dispersed in the whole structure. And besides, The EPR spectrum obtained at liquid nitrogen temperature shows that less than 25% of the vanadium ions are in the tetravalent state. Trivalent vanadium, which has two electrons in the D shell, cannot be seen. And then, as you can see here, the spectrum is significantly modified. As you see in the lower left part, it agrees with what could be expected according to the intermediate band scheme, which is shown in the lower light part, which implies that all these three transitions can occur. A few years later, we tested the spectral response of both pure indium sulfide and vanadium substituted indium sulfide in the degradation of aqueous acid, formic acid. The results shown in the reference in the at the upper left were as shown. The upper part shows that again, the effect of filters and the rate constant below show that the spectral response of vanadium substituted indium sulfide is extended to almost the near infrared range. The most interesting results are shown here. The photoluminescence test carried out at ambient temperature show that, as could be expected, with excitation wavelengths shorter than the band gap, the photoluminescence appears at the correct band gap wavelength. But with excitation wavelengths longer than the band gap, only vanadium substituted indium sulfide shows photoluminescence. Although at the wavelength some shorter, while pure indium sulfide shows none. You can see this in part A of the graph. Besides, as part B shows, the extent to which the photoluminescence is extended coincides exactly with the extent to which the spectral response is extended. You may compare both results, which means that holes at least can fulfill the photocatalytic redegradation of a formic acid. And part C shows that the photoluminescence intensity depends linearly, not quadratically, on the incident intensity, which means that both transitions can take place independently. Agreeing again with the scheme shown here at the center right. In addition, we carried out a test with terephthalic acid, which is known to give upon reaction with OH radicals a product that gives fluorescence. Here it is shown that while pure indium sulfide cannot give such fluorescence, which irradiated with light longer than its band gap, vanadium substituted indium sulfide is able to produce that fluorescence when irradiated with light longer than its band gap, which confirms again that vanadium substituted indium sulfide can produce OH radicals. Let's now look at the spectral response of zinc indium sulfide, which structure is shown here to the left. The reference for this work is again shown in the upper left part. Again, its generation via hydrothermal synthesis gave rather good surface area. But there is some uncertainty whether it has a direct or indirect gap. Consequently, we carried out using VASP a hybrid DFT calculations with the result that zinc indium sulfide has an indirect gap, but very close to the direct gap. Then we tested its spectral response in the aqueous degradation of the formic acid and could verify that it has the possibility of to extend its wavelength a bit more into the visible, probably because of defects in its structure. However, the resistance of this sulfide to the degradation is rather weak. This is probably because zinc tetrahedrally coordinated is more prone to the degradation, which means that it may be useful in reduction-reaction using a sacrificial reagent, but not otherwise. Now we go into the main objective of this talk, how to combine enzymes with these sulfides in order to achieve water splitting. In principle, generating hydrogen can be achieved with several inorganic catalysts, as is shown here. But here we will use enzymes. In particular, for evolving hydrogen, we will use a mutated hydrogenase containing in the active site a bimetallic iron-nickel cluster with the ligands shown here. When combined with indium sulfide, electrons excited by visible light in the conduction band can cascade through three iron sulfur clusters into the active site so as to generate hydrogen. The lower left part indicates the article showing this result. This is the experimental setup used. A is the irradiation source. B is the indium sulfide suspension, which initially has not the hydrogenase added, but afterwards the latter is added. C is the agitation system. D is the mass spectrometry system used for hydrogen detection. And E is the computer gathering the hydrogen production data. And these are the results. As you can see, with indium in suspension, with no hydrogenase added, there is no hydrogen production. But once the hydrogenase is added, as soon as light appears, hydrogen begins to be generated. With light off, no hydrogen is produced, but production of hydrogen starts again as soon as light appears. This means that hydrogenase, in connection with indium sulfide, is an effective catalyst for hydrogen production. There is, in addition, another interesting result. We compare here, for different incubation times, the hydrogen production activity when irradiating the indium sulfide plus hydrogenase activity, these are the black columns, with the hydrogen generated in the dark with hydrogenase alone, the oblique red stacked columns, when an excess of reduced methylbiologen is added. This reduced methylbiologen is known to be a very good generator of hydrogen in presence of this hydrogenase. By comparing both results, it is clear that it is not the irradiation of the indium plus hydrogenase which controls the rate of hydrogen generation, but rather it is the reaction of reduced methylbiologen with the hydrogenase which controls the hydrogen generation process. Now, let's go to the oxygen generation process. For this, we used a Trametres Hirsuta lactase. These lactases, which contain a 4-atom copper active center, are normally used to reduce the oxygen to water without stopping at the intermediate product hydrogen peroxide. This is the process described here at the bottom right. But in this reference here, it was proven that also the reverse situation, the oxidation of water to give oxygen without stopping again at the intermediate product hydrogen peroxide, can be achieved using the reaction shown here. Therefore, we built a setup consisting of indium sulfide connected to a fluorine doped tin oxide. The lactase was covalently bonded to indium sulfide, and the circuit was completed with, on the one hand, a platinum wire to generate hydrogen, and on the other hand, a sensor of dissolved oxygen so that its concentration can be measured as soon as oxygen is generated. The lower left part indicates again the article showing these results. These are the first results. In this slide, I present a cyclic voltagogram showing in the lower part three plots obtained in the dark, evidencing that nearly no current is obtained in that case. But once the irradiation begins, it can be seen that important currents can be obtained only in the presence of both indium sulfate and the lactase. And besides, the insert here shows that only under irradiation and in the presence of indium sulfide and the lactase can oxygen be obtained, while in the dark, no oxygen is generated. In this slide, I present now coronamperimetric data. In the left part, I show results with indium sulfide deposited on fluorine doped tin oxide, but without the lactase. When illuminating, a first spike appears, which is probably due to a charging effect, but no oxygen appears. But in the right side, you can see that once the lactase is added, oxygen is generated, and its increment, once the appropriate quantification is done, coincides almost exactly with the difference between the results with and without the lag case. Here I present a table indicating at different potentials the charge transfer, the amount of oxygen generated, and the corresponding Faraday yields. If we go to the previous slide, we can see that the Faraday yield at 1 volt coincides with the expected value. But the interesting thing is that in the absence of light, the first hints of oxygen only appear at 1.55 volts. This means that with light, there is a decrease in overpotential of more than 0.7 volts, which is certainly an interesting result. Now let's go and see what happens with the tin disulfide. The appropriate reference can be seen in the left bottom side. Light excites electrons to the conduction band of tin disulfide so that they may generate hydrogen at the platinum wire, while holes are transferred to the lag case, and in the end, oxygen is generated and measured with a sensor of dissolved oxygen. In this case, however, indium doped tin oxide nanoparticles at 1% amount are used to improve the electrical contact. Here, I show the chronoamperograms at 1 volt. The red curve is without the lag case. The black curve is with it. One sees that upon irradiation, without the lag case, no oxygen is produced. But while with the lag case, significant amounts of oxygen are generated. However, in the right side, one can see that without the lag case, there is a progressive decrease in current, whether light used is used or not, which may mean that because the lag case is not present, tin disulfide is slowly photocorroded. This is a bit surprising since, as said in slide 8 above, tin disulfide is less prone to photocorrosion than indium sulfide. However, as soon as the lag case is included, the increase in photocurrent, although smaller, is stable. This means that holes are easily transferred from tin disulfide through the lag case to water, generating oxygen, and no photocorrosion of tin disulfide takes place. In this other slide, I note that both the obtained current and the oxygen generated increase with the light power applied. But special attention should be paid at the Faraday efficiencies. With the lower light power, they are more than double than with the higher power, which gives an additional idea on the possible photocorrosion of tin disulfide. And finally, the photocorrosion is confirmed by this graph and these tables. It is clear that the lower is the voltage, the higher is the Faraday efficiency. Therefore, it remains to be seen which would be the best voltage to reach the maximum Faraday efficiency. But furthermore, if we compare with the results mentioned above for indium sulfide, the highest Faraday efficiency with tin disulfide is already seen for 0.4 volt. While for indium sulfide, the first results were obtained with only at 0.8 volts. This means that there is a decrease in overpotential of at least 1.1 volt when using tin disulfide, which agrees with the lower valence band position of tin disulfide shown in slide 5. Finally, I will introduce preliminary results of ours, in which a formate dehydrogenase enzyme has been used. In this case, that enzyme has a tungsten as main active site, which links with 4 iron sulfur clusters, allowing shuttling electrons back and forth. The reference indicated here shows that it can be linked with gold or graphite electrodes to work as CO2 reductant or formate ions oxidant. What we have done here is to link it with indium sulfide so that light can excite electrons to the conduction band of indium sulfide and be transferred to the formate dehydrogenase, so that CO2 is reduced to formate, while a sacrificial agent supplies holes to the valence band of indium sulfide. The diagram at the upper right shows that indeed indium sulfide is able to produce formic acid, which then may dissociate to formate. This work is still in progress and corresponds to the reference shown in the lower right part here. The setup used is explained here. The indium sulfide, together with the formate dehydrogenase, is incubated during different times at 4 degrees Centigrade to obtain a suspension. Then the photocatalytic reduction of CO2 is carried out during 5 minutes using a lamp providing visible light at the pH shown here. Using as sacrificial agents either dithiotritol or the latter together with sodium sulfide added. Finally, the formate is analyzed using ionic chromatography. The results obtained until now are as follows. It seems that dithiotritol alone gives higher conversion and in less time than the mixture of dithiotritol and sodium sulfide. This is a bit surprising, since one would think that by adding sodium sulfide to dithiotritol, the yield of formate would be enhanced. But there are unclear results concerning the formate concentrations obtained. This implies that further work is needed to verify the reason for this. Hopefully, these remaining uncertainties will be solved. Once these things are clarified, we may undertake the photoelectrochemical process of CO2 reduction to formate. And with this, I finish my presentation. I must give thanks to the financing agencies that have made these results possible, to the computer which allowed the hybrid DFT results to be obtained, and finally, to all of you for your kind attention.